left. Maybe talk about some of the families that were in and out of our lives during the years, neighbors, Kufax, I mean, just whatever, wherever your mind goes, just think about, tell stories or...
Probably the first would be Lutz, wouldn't they?
Yeah, because they lived on this farm, we bought the farm, and then he left his hogs here until they were going to go to market. So they would have to come over every morning, and Joyce would come and help him with chores, but she's such a short person, and she'd wear this old wool overcoat of somebody's that looked like a Gestapo man.
Army jacket, army coat.
And it hung halfway to her ankles, three-quarters of the way to her ankles, and we'd always get a kick out of that. So we'd always hear the flappers of the hog feeders out there.
Well, you said Joyce was your savior for you.
She was a savior. She was my mother, my sister, my friend, all rolled into one. I don't know what I would have done on the farm without Joyce. She came from town, too, and was a farmer, so she knew what I was going through. And she would babysit for Bruce when I had the sewing class, and he was always very hungry when he went to her house. He'd just get in the door and say, "Joyce, I'm really hungry." And she knew what he wanted. It was the little cereal boxes, because I wouldn't spring for those. That was too expensive way to get cereal. And one year, Joe broke his leg, so Dad harvested his crop for him. And Joe insisted on paying, because he was off from work. It was winter, he wasn't working much. And it was one of the early years we were here, right? And Joe insisted on paying for him. He said, "I don't want you to pay me for it. I just did it because I'm your neighbor and you would do it for me." But Joe insisted on paying for it. So.
What other neighbors?
Well, Glenn Gloy over there loaned us his...
Well, we made hay together for quite a few years.
With Glenn.
I didn't have a baler then. I didn't have...
Old cedar.
Yeah, I used his
drill,
grain drill for seeding oats, and we needed trade labor.
And then the neighborhood, all of area farms, they had a ladies' potluck group, so they invited me right off. We were still living up in the Brown House. Two of the ladies stopped and invited me to come to the next meeting. And I said, "Well, I've got a little one at home. That's all right. Little ones can come." So Bruce came with me to potluck for the first few years until he went to kindergarten. That's when he heard about when we were at a lady's house that was kind of large, and she had her Christmas tree up, and he said, "Tell the fat lady we have a tree too."
So who all was part of that early potluck group?
Bakers.
Lois.
Lutz.
Hoffman's.
Carlson's.
Burbs. Marinko. She had just moved to the neighborhood too. She wasn't on a farm, but she got invited because the lady in her house had been part of the group. Janowski, she's living all that too, but the first lady. And that's about it. There was about a dozen. In the earlier days, there used to be more children there than there were mothers and but not about this time. We were the young family that came in that had, and then Osagians moved into the Gloy place, and they had three boys, so a couple of them would come for a while. And then Sue Jacobson came, and they had two boys to bring with, so then we had a few more coming for a while. So. It was very fun. It's still going on today. Different people have moved into the places, so there's only a few of us old-timers left, but...
Getting back to the part of what shaped my early life that would push me as hard as it did to stay with farming, and what I loved to do was, my dad died when I was 8, so I didn't have a strong relationship with a male like my father. I remember at the age of 7, my dad led me to Christ, and I had to be thankful for that.
So you have the strong father figure of Uncle Alvin through the years.
Yeah, good, you know, good and bad characteristics, whatever rubbed off on me, I guess you can blame him for a lot of it.
But your love for the farm?
Yeah.